Chapter 12, Equilibrium and Elasticity. We'll start out with 12.1, Equilibrium. And equilibrium is something we've already alluded to in the previous chapters, especially chapters 5 and 6, where we dealt with equilibrium when we talked about Newton's second law. And then we also saw it once again when we got into rotation in chapters 10 and 11. So, to introduce it, let's take a look at these four items below. There's a textbook, a hockey puck on ice, a ceiling fan, and a bicycle wheel. Amazingly, all four of these demonstrate equilibrium. So what does equilibrium mean? Well, they all have the characteristic that the linear momentum of the center of mass is constant. The angular momentum about the center of mass or any other point is also constant. So note, to be in equilibrium doesn't mean that you're stationary necessarily. Just means that you have a constant linear or angular momentum, that the P, the system, is a constant, or the L is a constant. And that's true for all of these. They aren't picking up any additional speed, right? The bicycle wheel is rolling at a constant speed. The ceiling fan is just spinning. The hockey puck is moving on ice, where it's able to travel at a nice constant velocity, and the book is sitting there. Now, within these, we could ask, okay, which of these is a static equilibrium? First, what is static equilibrium? Which static equilibrium is mostly what we're going to focus on in this chapter, and it makes things a lot easier. It's the same as statics in engineering. This is the basis of all of that. So this is where not only is the linear and angular momentum a constant value that's not changing, but it's a value that's equal to zero. In other words, something that is not moving. So the examples in here that are a static equilibrium would be the textbook. And I love that this popped up. This just shows that Google knows me. I just did an image search for book. And that was one of the results. Our textbook, Halliday and Resnick, a very much older edition, but the same textbook that we were using. So that's kind of cool, kind of creepy, but kind of cool. All right, so we briefly discussed static equilibrium, or stable and unstable, back in chapter 8, section 3, where we said if a body returns back to equilibrium after being pushed slightly to one side, that's a stable static equilibrium. We talked about the marble inside a bowl. And then instead, if a small displacement ends the equilibrium, we call that unstable. And we talked about a marble on top of a bowling ball. If you push it just a little, whoop, it's gonna fall off. And what this means is that images like this one, where you see this amazing rock that somehow is balanced like that, the rock is actually in static and stable equilibrium. Because if it was an unstable equilibrium, all it would take is a slight breeze and the rock would tip. But instead, it's been there for decades, somehow balanced. So even though it doesn't look stable, it actually is pretty stable. Now, here's some more examples looking at it. We have a domino. In figure A, this shows unstable equilibrium. This is if you manage, I'm not this good, but maybe you're better than me, and you can balance a domino right on its corner. It's balanced right on its corner, then all it takes is the slightest push, and it tips off, right? And that's what we see in part B, where it is tipping over. And the key here is how the force of gravity acts on the center of mass of the object. And as soon as the force of gravity passes that supporting edge, that's when it's unstable and it's going to fall. So A, it's right on the edge. In part C, it is a stable equilibrium, but you can't push very hard on the domino at all, or else it will start to fall and it could start a chain reaction, right? But it is still stable because notice the force of gravity isn't right on either edge. We can make it even more stable if we give it a wider base, right? That's what our block is here. It has the same height as the domino, but by having such a much wider base, you have to push a lot harder and longer to knock over the block or to make it roll. So our requirements for equilibrium, our big key equations of this chapter, are given by Newton's second law in linear and rotational form. In other words, that F net has to equal zero because there's no acceleration, and net torque has to equal zero. There's no angular acceleration. This is known as the balance of forces and the balance of torques, that they need to balance out. So therefore we have for equilibrium, in terms of words, the vector sum of all the external forces that act on a body must be zero. The vector sum of all external torques that act on the body measured about any possible point must also be zero. And that part's a key detail because we'll see that we will often shift the point that we choose to measure the torques around to help ourselves out, make our lives easier. Now we'll often simplify matters by only considering forces in the XY plane. We'll just look at a two-dimensional picture and that works really well. All the problems I can think of for this chapter follow that. So F net of X sums to zero, F net of Y sums to zero, right? Breaking it down into X and Y components yet again. And then the balance of torques, the net torque has to be zero. And that is technically in the Z direction because of right-hand rule, but that's not too critical here. Now note, for static equilibrium, we have these additional requirements as mentioned, that the linear momentum must be zero, the angular momentum must also be zero. So there we have it. That's all the equations we need for most of the problems here in a nutshell. And notice none of these equations are particularly new, but we're gonna go more in depth with them and see some examples. So let's look at a checkpoint. So as the figure gives an overhead views of a uniform rod on which two or more forces act perpendicularly to the rod. If the magnitudes of the forces are adjusted properly, but kept non-zero, in which situations can the rod be in static equilibrium? You can vote for more than one. Okay, well, I want you to think about this. So go ahead and hit pause and see what your answer is. Okay, did you do it? I'm hoping so. So if we look at these, we notice that we can adjust the amount of the forces. So we can balance the up force with the down force. That part's not a problem. But the key detail here is going to be making sure that if we're pushing up on one side and down on another, that we don't just cause a rotation, which is what I'm getting for one. If I have finger pointed up and another one going down, it's really hard to not have it rotate. And you can try this out. I recommend with just, could just be your pencil or a ruler, right? But just rest it on the table and try pushing in the various configurations and see if you can adjust not the placement of where you're putting the forces, but how much you're pushing and if it can balance out. So two, I get the same thing, right? This time one side's pushing up and I have two going down, and it's not going to balance out. But notice three is a bit different, because for three, I have one force pushing up and then two forces pushing down on either side. And that now I can balance it out. I'm able to hold this up, assuming I have balance. So there it does work, right? Where we notice that in all of them, the balance of forces can be zero. But the key is also getting the balance of torques to be zero. So let's try three more. I want you to try these out, especially now that we've talked through it a little bit. So please hit pause now and figure out which ones could be in static equilibrium. All right, did you do it? I'm hoping so. So we can test it out yet again. with, let's see, number four has two pushing up on one end and then two pushing down, something like so. And no, I can't get that to balance. Let's try number five. Five, we have two pushing down and two pushing up off to one side. And yeah, that seems to balance. I think I'm meeting the description, right? Notice that my pinky doesn't need to push down hardly at all. So it's not a large force or else it would tip, but I can adjust the magnitude so that it does in fact balance. And then similarly for six, my hands aren't wide enough to do the full reach that would be, but if we have two on the outside edge and two in the middle, this again can balance as well. And so I would say five and six do balance, but four does not. Yeah, so we get three, five, and six for all of these together. And what we see here is that because we need the torques to balance, then if you think of like the up is could be like a pivot, you need the amount pushing down on one side of that to equal the amount pushing down on the other. If you have two pushing down on the same side opposite that support, it's not going to balance out. So this is where balancing the torques matters. If we're creating a clockwise torque, it needs to be balanced by a counterclockwise torque. All right, one last thing in this equilibrium section. Gravitational force on body is the sum of the gravitational force acting on all the individual elements of the body, which are just the atoms, right? We all have plenty of atoms inside of us. But we can simplify this. Instead of saying that I need to consider all of the atoms inside me, which would be very painful for the calculation, we can say the gravitational force on the body effectively acts at a single point called the center of gravity of the body, which is often abbreviated as COG. Until now, we've assumed the gravitational force acts at the center of mass, which is approximately true for the everyday case. In most cases, gravity acts on our center of mass. In many cases, we'll see that the center of mass is the same as the center of gravity. Key is that it is the same if G is the same for all elements of the body. What does this mean? Well, if you have, say, a skyscraper, as it gets really, really high up from the Earth, this has to be a really tall skyscraper, the value of G, the acceleration due to gravity, will change very slightly. And so that's something to account for, that the center of gravity might not be exactly the same as the center of mass when you account for the fact that G is changing. But if G is the same, which it really is in the everyday case, then the COG is equal to the COM. And we can show this mathematically. By considering a sum of torques on each element of the body versus the torque caused by the gravitational force at the center of gravity. So if we sum the torques on each element, that would be the xi times the force of gravity on each I element. And so that's considering the x here is the moment arm, right, which connects from the rotational axis to the line of action, which is anywhere in line with that force. And then, and so what we're going to do is substitute in the mass elements times G for FGI. So however much mass is at that point times the value of gravity at that point. Now, if G is constant, then instead of writing it G sub I, we can just write it as G, and it comes out of there and it divides out. And what we're left with is that X cog is equal to the, or times the sum of the masses is equal to the summation of xi times mi. So we divide the summation of the mass to the other side, and we get x cog is equal to 1 over m times the summation of x times m. And this term on the right is the equation we got for the center of mass. So this isn't actually a new idea. In most cases, we'll just be able to say center of gravity, it's the same as center of mass. And the key here is that once you know the center of gravity or the center of mass, then you can say the force of gravity acts at that point. And that's very important when we're calculating torques. We have to know where each force acts. So that's where we want to go in knowing our center of gravity and center of mass. And we'll look at some examples of this and static equilibrium in the next section.